We can get started now. So today's topic is quasi-Newton method. The motivation for studying quasi-Newton's method is, we know that Newton's method is pretty fast, so we should use it in practice all the time, but because of the computational burden, we don't want to use Newton's method. So the idea is, can we approximate the second derivative inverse in a very simple manner so that we can get the benefits of Newton's method without actually doing the complicated computation. So what I'm going to do today is start with the motivation for quasi-Newton's method, and then we will talk about actual quasi-Newton method, and in particular DFP and BFGS method, which are two well-known quasi-Newton method. So we want to minimize a function fx, x is in Rn, and in order to compute this optimal solution, we will run a gradient descent method, which is xk plus 1 equals xk minus alpha k dk gradient fxk. Right? We want dk to be positive definite. Now, if dk was equal to second derivative at xk inverse, then this is Newton's method. Right? So we want to approximate this matrix. So let's say we started with x naught, and we computed from x naught, we computed gradient of fx naught, and then we define x1 equals to x naught minus alpha naught let's say gradient of fx naught. Okay, so dk is identity here, or d0 is identity. And we continue this way, so x 2 equals to x1 minus alpha 1 d1 gradient of fx1 and so on. Okay, where D0, D1, D2, all these are matrices that we would like to identify. Let me define PK equals XK plus 1 minus XK and QK to be gradient of FXK plus 1 minus gradient of fxk. So this is, I'm adding some notation here. Okay, what do we know about QK? So Taylor series tells me that QK is approximately equal to second derivative of fxk plus 1 into PK. Right, so this equation is clear to everyone. Okay, so QK is almost equal to the second derivative of the function evaluated at xk plus 1 multiplied by pk, which is a vector. Okay, so this is a vector, this is a matrix, this is a vector. Now assume that our step sizes are small enough, so x0, x1, x2, all the way up to xn are close to each other, and the second derivative will not really change significantly going from x0 to xn. Then we can have the approximation which is that q0 is roughly equal to second derivative xn p0, and then qn is approximately equal to second derivative at x0 pn, or n minus 1 xn. Okay, so this is an approximation that we are making. When is this approximation exact? Any thoughts? When is this approximation exact? No longer an approximation? No. When the function f is quadratic, okay? So then none of this is an approximation, it's equality everywhere. So if f is quadratic, we have equality everywhere. No difference, it's not an approximation at all. Okay. So I'm going to collect all these terms together, and what I get is p0 to pn minus 1 equals q0 to qn minus 1. So this is a square matrix, this is a square matrix, this is also a square matrix. Okay. Is this step clear to everyone? Yeah.
There should be q0 is approximately equal to x1.
This is?
Yeah.
Yeah, so what I'm saying is all of these x's are close to each other, so the second derivative does not change going from x0 to xn. And so I'm using that approximation and writing xn here. Okay. So there is a lot of approximation here, and all that approximation goes away. It becomes equality when the function f is quadratic. If it is not quadratic, then these are all approximations. When it is quadratic, the second derivative actually doesn't depend on xn, and that's why there is no approximation anywhere. Okay. Now, if I want to compute second derivative at xn, that is equal to q0 qn minus 1 p0 pn minus 1 inverse, assuming these are linearly independent. Okay, so I'm making many assumptions right now which I'm not explicitly writing. So if these vectors p0 to pn minus 1 are linearly independent, then I can move this matrix on this side, take the inverse, and this yields, I can compute the inverse by pn minus 1 . Okay, these are all implications. Oh, I should have approximation everywhere, not equality. Okay, any questions so far? Okay, so we have used a lot of approximation to get to this point, but we have a problem here that we again need to compute the inverse of a matrix, which potentially could be large if the value of n is very large. So we need to come up with some other idea, right? We need to come up with another idea in order to compute. So this would potentially be dk. So we need another idea to compute dk. What should we do? Yeah.
You only need 3 points to approximate the second derivative, right?
Why 3 points?
So if you're trying to compute concavity, right?
Right.
So for one of these entries, right?
So. No, I don't think so. This is an n-dimensional object, right? So you can't use 3 points to compute. No, the second derivative or any information about the second derivative. Okay, so the idea is let's start with some simple idea. So I start with some d naught, and I want to use the information about pk and qk in order to compute d1. Okay, and I start with a positive definite matrix, and I want to update that positive definite matrix when I'm going to the next step. So let's try a wild idea of taking d1, or rather dk plus 1, to be dk plus ak zk zk transpose, where ak is a positive number. Okay? So this is a rank 1 update. Rank 1 update to dk. Yeah.
I couldn't understand this last step.
Yeah, so we want to go from d naught to d1, and then d1 to d2, and so on. The only requirement is that each of these d's should be positive definite, right? So a wild idea is, instead of trying to update with a complicated expression, why don't we just add a rank 1 matrix, positive semi-definite matrix? Because then that will preserve the positive definiteness of dk when we do the update. And all we need to figure out is an n-dimensional vector and a scalar ak. Okay, that's it. That's the only thing I need to figure out in order to do this update. And the information we have is pk and qk. Okay, so hopefully we can come up with a method so that I can compute zk, and let me write zk is an Rn, and the question is find ak zk such that dk plus 1 is positive definite. No, actually, not dk plus 1 is positive definite. So the question is, we need to find ak and zk such that it has to satisfy some condition. It will, by definition, if ak is positive, and this is a rank 1 matrix, a positive semi-definite matrix, it gets added to a positive definite matrix, so it will be positive definite. But we need to make some, we need this dk plus 1 to satisfy some property so that we can compute what zk and ak should be like. So a possible idea is we want dk plus 1 multiplied by qk to be equal to pk. Okay? And of course, dk has to be symmetric. But this symmetry will automatically, dk plus 1 has to be symmetric, but this matrix will always be symmetric, so we don't have to worry about this requirement. Okay, so let's go over the train of thought once more. So this approximation works, but I still need to invert a matrix, so I don't want to do that. So I'm going to try to update dk in a manner that every point of time I just add a positive semi-definite matrix to dk. Okay, this matrix will be positive semi-definite if ak is positive and zk is any vector in Rn. All right. Now this dk plus 1 needs to satisfy, so I can pick any ak positive and zk in Rn, but it should satisfy some property which allows me to say that dk plus 1 is very close to the second derivative of the function at that point. So obvious condition that dk plus 1 should satisfy is dk plus 1 multiplied by qk is equal to pk. Okay, we remember dk is second derivative inverse, so we just want this equation to be satisfied by an appropriate choice of ak and zk. So let's find out what should be the value of zk and ak look like in order to solve that, in order to have equality there. So dk plus 1 qk is the same as dk plus ak zk zk transpose qk, which is equal to okay, so dk multiplied by qk plus ak zk zk transpose qk. Okay, and we want to find, again, we want to find zk and ak. These two are unknown, so ak is unknown, zk is unknown. QK is known, PK is known, and DK is known. Okay, so this should be equal to PK. That's what we want. So this implies that ZK is equal to PK minus dk qk over ak zk transpose qk. Okay, is this step clear to everyone? Okay, let me define RK to be PK minus DK QK. In that case, ZK, AK, ZK, ZK transpose is given by RK, RK transpose over AK, ZK transpose QK square. This is a definition. Okay, so is this step clear? So I have zk given by this expression. Numerator is long, so I just want to write it in terms of rk, where I define the rk to be the numerator. So then ak zk zk transpose is rk rk transpose over some expression. Okay, so this is a scalar quantity and this is also a scalar quantity. Now all I need to, so this side is great because this is exactly the same term as what I need to add to dk, but the denominator still features zk, so I need to eliminate zk from here. So let's try and figure out how can I eliminate this term ak and zk from the denominator. So I have pk minus dk qk is given by this expression. So ak zk transpose qk zk. Okay, so that's coming from this expression. Okay, so I'm using this expression here to write this this thing. And this is, of course, by definition, we have called it rk. So let me multiply it by qk transpose on both sides. And I get or let me write it as qk transpose zk. Okay. Okay, is this step clear to everyone?
No.
Yeah. Yeah.
Isn't zk a vector? So how are you computing the?
So zk transpose qk is a scalar.
Oh.
This is a scalar, right? So then I can multiply qk directly to zk, qk transpose to zk. And now this is a scalar, and these two quantities are equal. And this expression is precisely the same as the expression in the denominator here. Okay? So, but what you can notice here is that rk is known, qk is known, this side is unknown, and this is precisely the unknown quantity in the denominator. So actually I get ak zk zk transpose to be rk rk transpose over qk transpose rk. Okay, okay, so let's go again back to our train of thought. So we wanted to update dk in a manner that we only add a rank 1 matrix at every point of time, and it has to be a positive semi-definite matrix. So for that, AK has to be strictly positive, which is great. So in order to do that, we need to compute AK and ZK such that this equation is satisfied by DK plus 1. Okay? Where did this come from? Well, it came from this expression where we wanted, we know that second derivative inverse multiplied by QK is equal to PK, or approximately equal to PK. So we want DK plus 1 to also satisfy the same relationship. Of course, it doesn't mean that DK plus 1 is second derivative inverse, but at least in some sense it is imitating the second derivative property at that particular point. Okay? Now, in order to get this expression, all I did was massage the expressions, you know, took things on the left side to the right side and so on, and we came up with this particular expression, okay, for the rank one update. Okay, now what is the problem with this expression? What's the problem with this expression? So remember, we need AK to be positive, and we need ZK to be any vector. I don't care about what that vector is. Now, what's the scalar here, and what's the vector here? No idea? QK transpose RK, okay? So we have 1 over QK transpose RK, RK, RK transpose, right? So this is the same expression. So this is, I can call this as AK and I can call this RK as ZK, okay? And I'm done. But the problem is I don't know whether this quantity is positive or not, right? We need this quantity to be positive, QK transpose RK to be positive. Okay, so if it is positive, we are in good shape. If it is not, then we are in bad shape. Okay, and therefore, this particular method is not very good because it depends on whether this quantity is positive or not. Okay, so our rank one ideas doesn't seem to be helping us a lot in this particular situation. All right. So can we take this idea one step further? What would be a natural second step to try? Sorry? Ah, good. Okay. That's exactly correct. Okay. So rank one doesn't seem to work. Well, it works if this thing is positive all the time, but it's a priori, it's unclear whether this term is going to be positive or not. So we perhaps need to go to rank two update. Okay, so we need two such rank one terms, which we need to add to DK in order to get DK plus one. And so that's precisely what people did in 1970s. Well, not people, but two groups. So Davidson, Flesher, and Powell, they did it first for rank two update to DK, okay? And the method that they developed is known as DFP method based on their last names. And then the second set of people who did not update DK, but instead updated the second derivative itself. So remember, DK is second derivative inverse, or at least we want to imitate the second derivative inverse. So you can either update the second derivative itself, or you can update the second derivative inverse according to this rank two update scheme. So DFP method is about doing rank two updates to DK, and BFGS method is about doing rank two updates to the second derivative and then take the inverse of the second derivative, which can actually be done pretty easily. And so their ideas can actually be combined together in the following form. I'm going to write a very long expression now, so brace for impact. Real impact, you know, not the impact that causes death. Okay, so dk plus 1 equals to dk minus, no, plus. Yes.
Before you go on and talk about this one, when you going back to the question of whether a sub k was positive, is there anything more you can say about that, like conditions on the problem that would allow you to know that a priori that it's going to be positive, or is it like a 50-50?
Well, it can't be 50-50. It really depends on in which direction you are descending. So let's try to look at the quadratic case, because that's easy to solve. So I have, in the quadratic case, I have, RK depends on DK. So it really depends on what choice of DK you have. Let's look at QK transpose RK. UK transpose PK minus QK transpose DK QK. Okay. So let's assume that DK is Q inverse. So let's assume that DK equals to Q, well, let's assume that the function f of x is x transpose qx minus b transpose x, so a quadratic function, and then DK is actually equal to Q inverse. Then QK transpose RK is equal to what do I know about the relationship between QK and PK? So I know that DK QK equals to PK. Oh, so I have QK transpose PK minus QK transpose PK, which is equal to 0. Because of this. Okay, so what is happening? If your function is quadratic and your dk was exactly equal to the second derivative inverse, then actually this term qk transpose rk is equal to 0. Now, if this was not equal to second derivative inverse, then perhaps this would be, this could take any value. It could be positive, it could be negative. Now, this is always positive. This term is always positive because dk is positive definite, but with a negative sign. And this one, I don't know. It's unclear whether this is going to be positive or negative. Yeah. So, unfortunately, we can't really say when this is going to be positive or negative, okay? All right. So, let's go back to our discussion here. So, you can do... Let me erase. So has everyone noted this part down? I'm going to erase it. I need this space. Okay. So for C equal to 0, CK equal to 0, this is known as DFP method. And I think it was developed around 1970s. And then CK equals to 1. This is known as BFGS method. And this was 1970 plus epsilon. I don't know what that epsilon is. OK, maybe 71, 72, or something like that. Okay? Yes?
Did you mention how you initialize
DK? Initialize DK? Just take identity or whatever. Yeah. Okay? Yeah?
In the previous method with rank 1 update,
right.
How is ZK transpose QK a scalar?
How is ZK transpose, so ZK is a vector in Rn, QK is also a vector in Rn. So, yeah. So remember, QK is the difference between the derivatives, so it's a vector. Okay, so it's clear that when CK is equal to 0, then this is a rank 1 matrix and this is another rank 1 matrix, and therefore it's a it's a rank 2 update to DK. But when CK is equal to 1, there will be many cancellations, and then after that it will become a rank 2 update. Okay, so it won't be a rank 1 update, it would be a rank 2 update. But if CK is between 0 and 1, then this would be a rank 3 update of some sort. Okay, so it won't be a rank 2 update anymore. But CK is equal to 1 is through experience of many people, it has been shown to be superior to DFP method in the sense that the convergence of BFGS method is much better. Convergence properties are much better in practice. Okay, theoretically, they all come from the same family, but in practice, this turns out to have better properties. Okay. Once again, I want to emphasize. You get DFP method by rank 2 update of DK. You get BFGS method by doing rank 2 update of the second derivative itself. So there, let's say QK is some approximation to second derivative. Then QK plus 1 is equal to QK plus some Z1 transpose plus Z2 Z2 transpose, okay? So you are doing rank 2 updates to the second derivative, and then you take the inverse in order to get the expression for dk plus 1, and it will be a quite complicated expression, but there will be many cancellations, and you will get the BFGS method as a result. Okay? Now, the other important result to note is as follows. So let's look at this expression. DK is a positive definite matrix. This part is positive semi-definite. This part, I'm not very sure whether it's going to be positive or negative, right? Then I have this term, which is positive semi-definite, and this term, which is strictly positive, but there is a negative sign here. So I'm unsure whether, even if CK was equal to 0, I'm unsure whether the sum of these two matrices is going to be a positive definite or positive semi-definite matrix or not. But the proposition is that DK is positive definite and alpha K is such that gradient of FXK transpose DK is less than gradient of FXK plus 1 transpose DK, then DK plus 1 is also positive definite. Okay, so in particular, if alpha k equals to argmin alpha alpha dk, then this equation is satisfied. Okay. So going back, rank 2 updates to DK gives us, or either rank 2 updates to DK or rank 2 updates to QK gives us a series of algorithms for updating DK plus 1, which is indexed by CK. So you can pick any CK between 0 and 1. CK is equal to 0 was the first quasi-Newton method known as DFP method. CK is equal to 1 was the second quasi-Newton method known as BFGS method. And they both, BFGS method seems to be superior in practice. The only problem that you can have when you look at this particular expression is that I'm unsure whether what I'm adding to DK, which is three matrices, rank 1, but I'm unsure about positive semi-definiteness. This is also rank 1. I'm sure that it is negative semi-definite because of the negative sign here. And then we have another term, which is rank 1, but positive semi-definite, okay? So I'm adding three terms, three rank 1 matrices. I'm unsure whether this DK plus 1 is going to be positive definite or not. But this proposition comes to our rescue, which says that if your dk is positive definite, so let's say dk was identity, and you pick alpha k such that this equation is satisfied, then your dk plus 1 is guaranteed to be positive definite. Okay? Now, if alpha k was picked according to minimization rule, then this term is going to be 0, and this term is going to be strictly negative, and therefore, this equation will always be satisfied, and your dk plus 1 is going to be strictly positive. Now, the cool thing here is that, remember, you're trying to solve a minimization problem here, and so it's, in most situations, you won't actually solve the actual minimization problem all the way to, you know, 15 decimal places. You are going to truncate it at some point of time, and even if you do approximate minimization, this expression will likely be satisfied in most situations, and your dk plus 1 will be positive definite, for sure. Okay? Now, so therefore, even if you do approximate minimization instead of actual minimization, like complete minimization, this method is robust to such approximations when you do the minimization here in order to compute alpha k. Moreover, if your function f is quadratic, then and alpha k is picked according to this rule. Alpha k is the minimization of this. Then d0, d1, dn are q conjugate vectors. And this method, DFP method, boils down, or not DFP, but quasi-Newton method boils down to conjugate direction method. Okay, so this is similar to what we were doing in the previous class. If your function is quadratic, and if your alpha k is picked according to minimization rule. Okay, and this result requires quite a bit of effort to prove, because you have to show that all di transpose dj, no, di transpose q dj is equal to 0. So you have to do a lot of matrix manipulation in order to show that expression. Okay, any questions so far? So let's recap once more. I want to minimize a function. I don't want to compute the second derivative. I want to be able to use the successive iterate information to somehow estimate the second derivative inverse. We started with the idea that let's do a rank one update. We went through the expression and we realized that I'm not very sure whether dk plus 1 will be positive definite or not. So DFP, Davidson, Fleischer, and Powell, they had this idea back in 1970s that why don't we do a rank 2 update of dk? And then they found that indeed, if you do rank 2 update, your dk will be positive. If dk is positive definite, then your dk plus 1 is positive definite, because they were using this minimization rule to update alpha k. Very soon, BFGS realized that instead of doing a rank 2 update of dk, we can do a rank 2 update of qk and then take the inverse to get a expression like this. And that would also lead to this property, and it was found to be superior in practice. So now you can combine the two methods and parameterize it by xk. You can pick any xk between 0 and 1. And you will get a series of algorithms. And it turns out that for the entire set of algorithms, if dk is positive definite and this condition is satisfied, then dk plus 1 is positive definite. Moreover, if the function is quadratic and alpha k is picked according to minimization rule, then you are essentially running a conjugate direction method on this quadratic minimization problem. Okay? So that's the idea of quasi-Newton method. Nowhere in this method are we computing matrix inverse. It's just matrix multiplication and addition and subtractions. Very easy. It's not computationally very difficult to do matrix multiplication, additions, and subtractions. So that's what we are doing here. Now, the important thing to note is, even if you pick alpha k, even if you don't solve this minimization problem exactly, this property will still hold even if you have some inaccuracies in this minimization, and therefore your dk plus 1 will still remain positive. Oh, and in this case, your dn is actually q inverse. So after n iterations for the quadratic minimization problem, your dn actually becomes equal to q inverse. So that's all I have today. If there are any questions, I'll take it now. Otherwise, we'll reconvene on Monday. Yes?
You said that when we do the exact argument, then the right-hand side of that equation becomes 0.
Yeah, this term becomes 0. And this term is strictly negative because it's a descent direction. So remember, dk is, where should I write it? Dk is minus capital Dk gradient of f at xk. Right? So this term is negative, and this term is equal to 0 because you're doing the argument here. Okay, so if there are no further questions, we are going to talk about convex optimization problems. Well, constraint optimization problem, and in particular, optimization over convex sets in the next class. So I'll see you on Monday. Have a great weekend.